Wednesday, we can go straight to the microscope. And if we want to then reinforce some of the topics we're talking about today with hands-on with instrumentation. Okay. So, again, good afternoon and welcome to the Simons Electron Microscopy Center's EM course. Today we're going to go over the basic anatomy for an electron microscope. The lecturer today is Micah Rapp. He's your TA. He's a graduate student at Columbia, and he is really interested in adhesion molecules. And so that is something that we'll want to convey. So the foundational lectures primarily will be taught by our staff, but as we start roping in experts from other fields, it's curious and nice to know what fields they're studying in, because those fields might be orthogonal to what you're doing or might be right in an interesting field that you want to proceed into. And that is the key for the course, that human interaction to extend beyond just lectures online. Because again, we want to teach this in a reverse classroom. If you want to learn about the EM in detail, there's certain things you can look online already. What we want to do is touch upon the core concepts now, and then in the practical, start to build a foundation for you to have a better understanding of the tool that we use for CryoEM. If certain things that during the practicals are insufficient, please let us know, because again, as I said, we can augment. We had a very brief foray into plunge freezing and, let's say, spotted on chameleon. If you want more introduction into those instruments, please let us know and we can set something up. Okay, without further ado, Mike is going to take you into an EM.
Okay. So, yeah, this is our lecture on basic anatomy of electron microscopes. This is going to be relatively short, but hopefully people came prepared with questions that you would like to ask. This also presupposes that you have watched part one of Grant Jensen's Getting Started in CryoEM video course. So watch the assigned videos. Okay. If you didn't, sorry, you might be a little lost because I assume a certain level of like background information. But I've also peppered in some sort of concept questions that should refresh most of what he went over, but if you ever have any questions, stop, ask, and we can go over some stuff. We're lucky today to be joined by Michael Ehling, who is a research engineer, I think is your title here, who is a former employee of FEI, Thermo Fisher, who built, I think, every Krios in this
Krios building. 1, 2, 3, and part of 4.
Part of 4. Before we poached him, and now he works here.
No, that's wrong. He came to us.
He came to us.
Not
So, he came to us. But probably has forgotten more about electron microscope anatomy than I will probably ever know. So, we have a verified expert, so if you have any really detailed questions, he's the guy to ask. So, quick overview of what we're going to go over today. This is our basic cross-section of a transmission electron microscope, which is what we're going to be studying. In the past, we've sometimes touched on scanning electron microscopes, but as we're not really covering that anywhere else in this particular course, I just wanted to focus on transmission electron microscopes. And we are going to talk about guns and voltages, lens systems, and detectors. So, working essentially from the top of the microscope, starting with guns and voltages, and then ending at the bottom of the microscope with detectors. So I first want to start with a question. Why are we using electrons for microscopy in structural biology in the first place? So who has some pros, some reasons why we use them?
Small wavelengths.
Yeah. Perfect. Huh? Yeah, that's it. Those are the two main ones. They have small wavelengths, and we can actually focus them. X-rays also have small wavelengths and have some other pros, but extraordinarily difficult to focus. Does anybody know what the wavelength range that we normally work with is? We'll usually talk about electron speed as a unit of voltage, but that gives it a characteristic wavelength. Does anybody know like what the range is? Yeah. So it's in the picometer range, so we're talking hundredths of an angstrom. So clearly when it comes to resolution of our structures, the wavelength of our radiation, unlike light microscopy, is not the limiting factor. What about cons? What are some of the things that make electrons tough to work with?
Damage.
Yeah. So they interact with things, right? Nice negative charge, interact with atoms, and thus can destroy your samples. Anybody have another one? One more.
Easily dispersed?
Yeah, so we have poor sample penetration, right? They have very short scattering cross sections. Anybody know at, let's say, our, I think I had mentioned this last time, but at our sort of maximum speed, how far that electron is likely to go before it?
Are you under the nanometer?
Yeah, so 500 nanometers, half a micron, is the sort of theoretical limit. And as it gets thicker, you lose resolution. You get more inelastic scattering events. Things don't look as good. Ideally, for a single particle, we like to stay under 200, but really the thinner, the better. What's interesting is that sample damage gets worse if you use higher voltages, faster electrons, but sample penetration gets better. So it's this constant sort of weighing of the two. You go faster, and you can image thicker samples, but you're likely to damage your sample more. So one of our Journal Club assignments will examine some work by Chris Russo's lab, where they have taken a bit more of a detailed approach and are causing us to rethink what are the sort of best voltages that we should be using for electron microscopy. They're basically the worst option, except for literally every other option. If we could use anything else, we should probably be using those. If we could do microscopy with x-rays, those would probably be better. If we could do it with neutrons, also better, but those things, unfortunately, right now aren't super feasible, so we're stuck with electrons. I'm going to do some quick concept check questions on electron sources, just to make sure everybody's sort of up to speed. This should be really easy if you watch Grant Jensen's videos. So there are three main kinds of, we'll say, electron sources. So does anybody know what those three sources are? You just know one.
Tungsten.
Yeah, so we have tungsten filaments is one.
Six.
Yeah, lanthanum hexaboride. And field of machine guns. Yeah. So what are the advantages and disadvantages of some of those?
Tungsten's cheap.
Yeah, tungsten, super cheap, really easy to replace. Achieve really nice contrast. So you get lots of low resolution information. We'll talk more about contrast and spatial frequency next week when we do image formation, but you get nice, it's good for screening. Whereas field emission guns, expensive, but are also the most coherent, which I think leads to the next question. What's the difference between spatial coherence and temporal coherence? Yeah, so spatial coherence is the sort of spread of the electrons. Filaments are really bad. It's just kind of this rough spray of electrons, whereas field emission guns give you this really nice parallel beam. And temporal coherence, you're exactly right, is how fast they're moving. We normally measure them in electron volts or kiloelectron volts, right? So you'll hear about 120 kiloelectron volt microscopes, 300 kiloelectron volt microscopes. So something like a field emission gun, I think, has an energy spread of 1 to 2 electron volts, something like that, whereas a tungsten filament is a much wider range, so you get electrons coming off at different speeds.
Backing up, 60% of you during our survey said you have used an EM themselves. In terms of the people here that have used an EM, how many have used one with a tungsten filament? Okay, with a lab 6, and then with a FEG. That means if you're on a Crius.
How many of you had used one but didn't know what the electron source on the microscope was?
Okay. So then another way of thinking about that, how many people have used an electron microscope at 300 kV? Okay, most likely you've been using a field emission gun.
Yeah, I don't know of any KV scopes that use filaments. Yeah.
Is there any difference in terminology with electron microscopes between KVs and KEVs? They're essentially interchangeable with the electron microscope, right?
What do you mean?
Between KV and a KEV.
We just dropped the E, but okay. Yeah, it is technically an electron volt, which is some unit in joules that I can't remember. top of my head. But yeah, we'll say KV, KEV. We're all always referring to the basically the same unit. What is the high tension on the microscope? We'll talk about this. We'll use this when we actually operate them. So the high tension is that accelerator stack, if you remember from Grant Jensen's lectures, that will accelerate our electrons from the tip up to 120 kiloelectron volts or 300 kiloelectron volts. So something that we'll have to turn on, that might turn off if we crash the microscope, depending on the microscope that you're using. But yeah, effectively the speed. Just a weird phrase. Does anybody know how fast the electrons are moving, let's say, relative to the speed of light? So at 300 keV, we are at about 76% the speed of light.
My rough.
Yeah, 80 keV, which is the lowest voltage that we have here at SEMC, is about 50% the speed of light. So between 50 to 75% of the speed of light. Part of why they're so incredibly damaging, these things are moving nearly the speed of light. I'm just gonna go over some sort of standard configurations that you might see, things that you might use here, so that maybe the next time you're on a microscope, you'll actually have an idea of what the electron source is. So on the sort of low end, we have this sort of 80 to 120 keV range. Here we have a Joule 1230, which is our very small screening microscope that is down by the NMR magnets that you guys should have seen, I think, if you took the tour. That's at 80 keV. We have a Techni T12, which is being relocated, has been torn down, and is now moving to a new space, but is another one of our screening microscopes. These things, both of them have a filament, either tungsten or lab 6, and usually don't have direct detectors. So these are CCD or CMOS chips. I think our T12 is a CMOS. I don't know what the detector on the 1230 is.
It's a CCD.
We'll talk more about detectors at the end of this lecture if any of these phrases are confusing. The nice thing about them is that they're cheap. They're really fast. They're nice and robust, usually at really high contrast because of the filament and the fact that the microscope, ironically enough, isn't that good. You get all this low-resolution information but not high-resolution information, so you're not going to get to sub-3 angstrom reconstruction of your favorite protein.
Pause there. Can you go subatomic on this microscope? Yes, you can, but not a biological sample.
Right. Yeah, we'll talk about that probably more next week when we do image formation and the kinds of things that limit the resolution that we can use. But yeah, any of these microscopes, if you could just crank up the electron dose, would probably allow you to get to atomic
and
resolution.
Even on a CCD.
Yeah. The problem is that we, again, are using electrons, which are highly damaging, so we have to keep total number of electrons that our sample sees and experiences very, very, very low. But these are really good screening microscopes for biological samples. It's usually what you'll start out on. Then you might graduate to something in the 200 kiloelectron volt range, which are it's a fairly versatile set of microscopes if you're just looking at microscopes based on the voltage. We have a Techni F20 that operates at 200 keV. We have a Glacios that's being built that also operates at 200 keV. These things, ours all have FEGs. These are all field emission guns. We might have some with filaments. I don't know. I've never used a 200 keV scope with a filament, but.
Yeah, there are.
There are. They exist. They can have direct detectors or non-direct detectors, which means that they can be nice and versatile. They can be used for screening. Something like a Glacios can be used for high resolution data collection, where groups sort of are now more often getting to the sub-3 angstrom range with just 200 keV scopes. Almost always cryo samples. I've looked at negative stain samples on 200 keV scopes, but usually just because that was the only thing that was open at the time. But this is a very interesting range that can be either initial preliminary screening, initial data collection, where you might get to 5 or 6 angstroms with a biological sample, or you've really optimized things and you have a really, really nice 200 kV scope, you can get to near atomic. And then, of course, at the very high end, the one that everybody wants to use all the time, 300 kV, you have somewhat older models like the FEI Polara, or obviously most famously the Titan Krios or the Joule Cryo Arm. They have a really, really nice 300 kV scoop. These are equipped with all this top of the line stuff, right? Field emission guns, direct detectors, and then a bunch of other weird stuff that Grant Jensen might have talked about or might not. I think he talked about energy filters, phase plates, CS correctors, all of these other things that go into the microscope that help improve the imaging. These are capable of the highest resolution sub 2 angstrom range. I still think apoferritin at 1.6 something is the highest.
1.5 on a cold peg.
I think at 1.5 though.
Yeah.
So
just another question. What is the highest KV you've heard about? I think Grant mentioned
it's
one of them. What was the highest KEV microscope in existence or that has been in existence? There's a few of them around the world that are above this. Any idea? 1 million. They're in Japan. There's one in Albany. There might be a couple of other places. So what I want to separate would be the higher the number doesn't necessarily mean resolution per se, right? So 1 million, 1 MeV scopes have existed for decades. Extremely unstable.
So yeah, the fact that 300 kV scopes are currently being used for the highest resolution data collection doesn't mean necessarily that this is the best accelerating voltage for biological samples. And this is something that we'll talk about during the journal club, which I think is in early February. We'll talk about this. But there's some idea that we should be building microscopes that are this good, that have optics that are this nice at lower accelerating voltages because they damage our samples less if you've got something sufficiently thin. But right now, these are the ones. Yeah.
Is there any reason that you can't run one of these at a lower voltage?
Yes.
Okay.
Optics. So a lot of the lenses and stigmators and things, you get more unwanted lens aberrations at lower accelerating voltages. But I think the big fundamental issue, which we'll talk about ways that this is potentially being overcome, are the detectors themselves operate much worse at lower accelerating voltages. Because when that electron hits the detector, that electron itself will scatter. You get more scattering, less penetration at lower accelerating voltages, so your detectors function a lot worse. But again, there are ways around this with new detector technologies that will actually end this lecture.
Depends what you're doing. In truth, when we commission a Titan Krios, we do have the Gatan engineer tune our bioquantum at 200 keV, so we could use both modes. But as Micah said, optics. So it depends on what compromises you can get away with. And we typically don't do that.
Okay. So yeah, you can click a button and lower that accelerating voltage, but we usually set them up for one accelerating voltage. It'll be interesting to see if we can optimize this more for biological samples. Some concept check questions on electron lenses. Again, if this seems like very surface level stuff, it's because I assume you've watched Grant Jensen videos where he talked about electron guns for 30 minutes. So what are the three main lens systems in our transmission electron microscopes? They all have special names. Condenser is one. Objective lens systems.
Projection.
And projection lens systems. Nice. You have people who watched and paid attention. So each one of those lens systems have separate deflectors, and each one of those deflectors is given a special name. So maybe tell me what those names are. Beam is one. Gun deflectors. And image deflectors. So they all do the same thing, right? And we'll cover that, and Grant Jensen talked about it quite a bit. It just depends on what lens system they are a part of, and whether or not it is the lens system right after the gun, the one right before your sample, or the one after your sample. But they're essentially doing the same things. Does anybody tell me what hysteresis is? Almost. So
behavior when you're running forward versus reverse on a curve.
Yeah, that curve that he showed was great. essentially, the behavior of the lens will change as you change the current moving through it. More specifically, each lens remembers the magnification that it used to be at. So if you're operating at, let's say, a really high magnification, and then you go to a low magnification, you either reduced current in one of those lenses, or you've sometimes shut it off completely, and then you go back to that high magnification, it's going to remember the fact that it was at that lower magnification a little while ago. So you don't go back to the exact same magnification or settings that you used to be at. So there's memory in the microscope that we'll see when we do our practical tomorrow. We'll change magnification a bit, and we'll see how the beam changes. What is a crossover? Anybody?
Is that the degree to which in the condenser system you're focusing such that you get a crossover of the beam and then you can illuminate different amounts of your sample?
Yeah, exactly. So when we are focusing an electron beam onto our sample, we don't focus it onto a really, really tiny place. I mean, you could, but then you don't see anything and you just burn that one spot. So instead, we focus the electron beam to a point right above the sample. It then spreads out and illuminates an area of our sample, and we can control that crossover point. Yeah.
Why is crossover above the sample and not below? What's the reason for popping?
That's a good question. I know that you need to keep it very specific, so we'll go on the electron microscope and we can go, you rotate a knob left and right, so we usually just say you're left of crossover or right of crossover. Right of crossover is the crossover point above, left is below. I don't know why it's always going to be.
Processing wise, I'm accustomed to that.
Okay.
But if you want to do so, this is going to be coming in image formation. Point spread function of the microscope is also known as the CTF, the Fourier transform and point spread function. So there are certain equations that will have the correct aberrations. So the thought would be for CS corrected systems, you can actually correct or above if you put over the crossover and you collect and actually overfocus instead of defocus images. So there are ways to compensate for the envelope functions of the microscope. But standard image processing, we are used to, even for crow images, we invert them. So theoretically, we wouldn't even have to do that because we're trying to mirror what we do for negative scanning. So there's certain standards that we're used to for the processing pipeline. But computationally, yeah, it technically doesn't matter. But that it wouldn't be a streamlined workflow for you because you would have to rewrite a lot.
Okay. Was there a reason for it prior to software processing?
Well, negative stain was room temperature work, and then that set the standard of what visually you would think of as feedback. So before a lot of the improvements come, we were using our eyes for cues. And up until a few years ago, that's really good. At a certain point, though, I cannot see electrons, one. And two, I can't see high frequencies either. So therefore, my eye is only picking up lower resolution light, like photons actually. So there must be some translation there. And though our eye is really good at doing the initial stages, to say that can I see this micrograph is 1 angstrom versus 0.5 angstrom, I can barely tell you what a 10 angstrom micrograph looks like.
Okay.
Yeah. If I can add officially a good story there, but so crossover, so we have two modes, TEM, where you have like, we like to have a parallel beam through a sample, and then you have to crossover at your focus point. And you can also go to STEM, and that's what material science does. And then your crossover is exactly, it's like a little needle, like a tweezer. It scans really the surface. And then you you have a different optical modes, but then the crossover is exactly at your SEM.
Right. So imaging modes, we have transmission mode, stem mode, and then we can do diffraction mode by just pulling out the lens. So all that can be done on the same instrument. For biological scientists, actually stem mode is used.
Yeah, you're right. Now
it is, but we rarely do that.
We have lots of things in the anatomy of these microscopes that are almost holdovers from material sciences, because that's where a lot of this stuff was initially developed. So it'll be interesting to see if we get transmission electron microscopes that are explicitly set up to do biological imaging, and if that would help at all. It might not. Okay, so quick review. Again, Greg Jensen went over this in the lectures, but I wanted to make sure everybody got it. To how an electron lens works. Electron lenses are solenoids, so these are just coils of wire that wrap around here that now we have shown in cross-section, where each wire is just a little dark blue dot. We've got current going out this way and then coming in this way. Can anybody tell me what the three characteristics of an electron lens are? What three things does it do? So two of them are shared with optical lenses, things you use for light microscopy. One of them is somewhat unique to electron lenses. So they focus, magnify, and rotate, right? We have things focused on a specific point. That image becomes magnified, and because of how these lenses work, the fact that they are magnetic fields and dealing with electron trajectories, they also rotate that image as it gets magnified. So a lot of these, the microscopes that we'll use, do not allow you the sort of infinite control over the magnification. The manufacturer has selected specific magnifications to try to reduce this rotation. So if you go from a low mag to a high mag, you're going to get, at the very least, something like 180-degree rotations of the image, as opposed to all these weird in-between angles. So these coils of wires generate magnetic fields that look like this. We're just going to show two here, but they are symmetric around the lens. They kind of look like a donut. And down the middle of that lens is an optical axis. So here we've got an object along that optical axis, just for simplicity. And then it produces a magnified image at some point past that lens. And the relative, the ratio of this distance, so from the center of the lens to the object in the center of the lens to the image plane, determines the magnification. If an electron passes along this optical axis, it moves through essentially undeviated. But if you have an electron that is divergent from this object, this does what an optical lens does. It will take radiation that is divergent from the optical axis and then focus it to a point on the optical axis. And this is because the force experienced by this electron is the cross product of its velocity as well as the magnetic field. So what you get for some diverging radiation is forces that initially pull it in towards the optical axis, so it starts to essentially move around the lens. And now with this new velocity of it moving essentially circumferentially around the lens, it experiences forces that pull it out and then back towards the optical axis, doing what any good optical lens would do. For electrons, if you're allowed to use them in the first place. But these lenses do not operate alone. They are a part of lens systems. Again, this is an overview of what Jensen covered, but I wanted to make sure that everybody got it. Lens systems, I excluded apertures. There's always an aperture at the bottom. It's a plate with a hole in it. So I figured that was pretty self-explanatory. But we are imaging things at extraordinarily small scales. So when the manufacturer builds these microscopes, it's impossible to get them perfectly aligned, right? We have lenses that might be slightly shifted from one another. They could be at slightly different angles. They could be at slightly different angles from the electron source itself. So we have a set of deflectors above that lens that help get the incoming radiation along the optical axis. So the first deflector controls what's called shift. So in that question I asked, gun deflectors and image deflectors. There's the first deflector controls gun shift or image shift or beam shift, and then the second deflector controls tilt, gun shift, image shift, beam, tilt, or all of those. So if you have an electron coming down off the optical axis, the first deflector will bend that in towards the optical axis, which is controlling shift, and then the second deflector will bend it such that it now travels parallel to the optical axis and along that optical axis. The other component of a lens system are stigmators, which come after the lens, and these are used because the magnetic field generated by these lenses are never perfect. You might have one side or one patch that is stronger than another side. Can anybody tell me like why this might happen? Or why this might change throughout the life of the microscope? What are the sources of some of these imperfections in these magnetic fields?
Does that happen with like if the vacuum is sensitive?
Yes, that could happen. Yeah, you probably get a buildup of contamination every once in a while.
That causes charging, it could cause stagnation.
Yeah.
Perturbation of the beam. That actually happened.
So yeah, contamination is a good answer. We usually, very frequently, cryocycle our microscopes, which is basically just taking the microscope, warming it up, trying to burn off all of this contamination, and then cooling it back down. So contamination is a good one. Yeah, temperature shifts are a big one. It's one of the reasons why for our really nice microscopes, you don't operate the microscope in that room. Because just your presence in that room can change the temperature of the room, it can change the water cooling system that's keeping these lenses cool, and those fluctuations can change the resistivity of these wires that make up the lens, which will change the magnetic field, which will change its ability to focus it correctly.
Does anyone know where the main heat load of the microscope goes? Into a water system that's cooling the lenses, the cameras, etc. So the heat actually given off by a microscope is really shuttled out of the room into a water bath, into a water loop.
And you get really, really big problems with your data collection if FEI has to come in and shut off the water cooling system and all of your lenses warm up, which has happened to me and is not fun to try to fix afterwards. So imperfections, you can also get some manufacturing defects, right? If one of those wires is slightly more kinked than the other wires in the area around it, you get changes in the resistivity of the wire and changes in the magnetic field.
Do you see changes in those over time as the lens systems age? Do you see any shift in those wires? Or
it's usually a board, right? Rather than the lens, but I mean, it's anything mechanical, anything physical can potentially break, but the core column usually has a good runtime of a couple decades.
Okay.
I mean, the monitors might change, the computers might change, boards might change, vacuum pumps might change, but the core column rarely.
If properly maintained, I'm sure, which we do a good job of. So stigmators are used to correct these imperfections in these magnetic fields, and they are essentially coils that will generate magnetic fields of a specific polarity in order to bend that electron beam back into something more symmetric. So you would get, this is what we call an astigmatic beam. So it has been focused by the lens differently. It's not perfectly symmetric, and this is actually what you see on the screen of the microscope, a beam that kind of looks oval like this. These coils will apply magnetic fields with a specific polarity such that it bends this astigmatic beam back into something that is nice and symmetric. Yeah.
Are there any cases where you would still have a bent electron beam after the stigmator, or is it usually fine at that point?
I mean, if you're, there is, depends on the microscope. Like on a Krios, those things are pretty well designed. The optics are really, really nice, especially these higher electron voltages. So once you've properly calibrated the stigmators, not calibrated, but aligned the microscope and looked at the beam, checked to make sure the beam is nice and symmetric, then yeah, usually it's fine. But on something like a lower end microscope, yeah, you still might have some astigmatism after your stigmators, especially if you haven't gone through alignment, but they do a pretty good job. It also depends on why you're collecting that data in the first place. if I'm screening something on a T12, I would like to correct for astigmatism, particularly if it's really bad. But sometimes, if you're not trying to get a really high resolution reconstruction of your sample and you just want to take an initial look at it, you might still have astigmatism because I just don't feel like spending the time aligning the stigmators and making sure they're doing their job.
Michael always has a properly aligned microscope. Don't listen to me.
Always.
Always.
Always take my time. Yeah, if I'm ever collecting an accretus, definitely. But sometimes it's late and I'm going to go home. So that's it for lens systems, and I'm going to spend the rest of the talk going over detectors in, I think, a little bit more detail. One, because I take slight umbrage with some of what Grant said about detectors. So there are two main types of chips that we use in electron microscopy. For our cameras, there are CCDs, charge-coupled devices, and there are CMOS detectors, complementary metal oxide semiconductors. These are camera technologies that are actually also used in photography and video cameras. So you can buy a DSLR that has a CCD chip or one that has a CMOS chip. Separate from that is whether or not they are photon-converted detectors or direct sensing, and I'll show you sort of what these differences are. So you can have a CCD or a CMOS detector that is photon-converted. You can have a CMOS detector that is direct sensing, but as far as I know, I don't think there are any CCD-based direct detectors. So if you just say, and this is I think what Grant said, he sort of said all CMOS detectors are photon converted, which isn't necessarily true. So you can have these sort of different combinations. So here's a little schematic of how photon converted detectors work and what the differences are between CCD detectors and CMOS detectors. The common feature is that they all use a scintillator to convert the electrons that come from our microscope into photons that will then travel down a fiber optic plate and then get read out as an image from there. How they treat that signal from the fiber optic plate is a little different. This is what separates CCD detectors from CMOS detectors. I am not an expert, and the details aren't super important, at least for this course. The thing to note is that CCD detectors essentially read out an entire image all at once through a limited number of sort of output nodes where the charge from the camera gets converted into some kind of voltage and then digitized and then sent to your computer. This is a fairly slow process because it's reading out the entire image all at once, whereas with CMOS detectors, each pixel will convert that charge into some kind of voltage and then read it out. So they are far more highly parallelized. So CMOS detectors are faster, and you actually have a slightly slower bandwidth. So each one of these like green arrows, right, is some readout from the camera. So here you only have one, here you've got a bunch, one for each pixel. But these are actually moving a little bit slower than this does, but because it's highly parallelized, you still end up with a net increase in speed. But that lower bandwidth actually reduces to a slight reduction in noise that comes from the camera itself. So most cameras that you'll see on modern TEMs in biology are going to be CMOS detectors. I guess if you're doing photography, sometimes CCD is better. These tend to produce more uniform images because, again, it reads everything out all at once, whereas you can get variation in the pixels and they read out here. And then the other type of detector are direct sensing CMOS detectors. So these have removed the need for this scintillator-based approach where our electrons get converted into photons, and instead just detect the electrons themselves through some very fancy engineering, which reduces the noise that comes from the detector, because when your electron, I think I've got an image of this in a couple of slides, and Grant also talked about it in the lecture. When the electron hits that scintillator, it will scatter in different directions, And each time it changes directions, which it does quite a bit, it will kick off photons, right? So it'll hit here, it'll move, and kick off photons over here, which leads to a blurring of the image. So moving to a direct sensing method reduces that noise. And this is also much faster, because we no longer have to wait for the acceleration and then the signal from the fiber optic plate. So we now have much faster detectors that have far less noise. And this is probably one of the major engineering accomplishments that has allowed us to sort of step into this resolution revolution. It's the ability to use much faster detectors that have less noise. When comparing different detectors, the main metric that we like to use, there's MTF, but the one I'm going to talk about now is the DQE, or detector quantum efficiency. So this is a plot that you can get from a detector where on the x-axis, technically we have the fraction of Nyquist. We'll talk about Nyquist frequency next week, but it's essentially here at zero, low resolution, here's one, high resolution. And then our DQE is essentially our signal to noise. So this plot is signal to noise as a function of resolution of the image. So most detectors start out with higher DQEs for low resolution information and then get progressively worse as we go to high resolution information. So just for a little bit of context, this camera here, the F416, is a CMOS photon converted camera that we have on our T12. We also have one on our F20. Our F20 has two cameras, so you can sort of slide them in and out. So you get this yellow trace here for photon converted CMOS detectors. Our F20 also has a direct detector. This is a DE12, we have a DE20. But it's a similar DQE curve for the DE20. So definitely better than our non-direct detector. And it moves so fast that we can correct movies and correct for drift of our sample, which is something that we'll talk about a little bit later on in the course. And then the detectors that are on our Priuses are all the way up here, super nice. These are the K2s, which are actually the old generation. There is now the K3. Upgrading to most of our, any of our new microscopes have K3s, which have even better DQEs. But a perfect camera would just be a flat line all the way across at one, but we're dealing with stuff that kind of looks like this.
Are any of those CCDs?
No.
Okay.
Those are all CMOS detectors.
Is there a US-1000?
Thing was there? Oh, yeah.
US-1000s. CCD.
Okay. So that one's all the way down here, the very bottom.
They used to put film there as a comparison.
This one I got from Ben Himes on Twitter. Interesting stuff. However, there is one new detector technology that is potentially very interesting for biological TEM. They are hybrid pixel array detectors. Has anybody heard of these before? Does anybody here do crystallography? If you've ever collected data at a crystallography beamline, the detector was probably a hybrid pixel array. So these are used in X-ray diffraction a lot, but somewhat recently have been stuck into transmission electron microscopes. This paper here was used a hybrid pixel array detector for electron diffraction, and then this paper from Chris Russo's lab at Ultra Microscopy used it for actual single particle transmission electron microscopy. And this is one of our journal clubs. So they are really, really nice detectors. One of their really interesting features is each pixel actually generates an electric field that serves to draw the electron down, which reduces the scattering, reduces that point spread function that Ed talked about, basically the blurring of the image, due to the fact that the electron will hit the detector a little bit. And they also capture, this is a plot, I think this was in the, I think Grant Jensen put this up on the videos, but this is the kind of scattering that, I can't remember what paper this came out of, but these are all potential trajectories of an electron after it has hit the detector. Quite a bit of scattering. And again, at each one of these places, they're kicking off photons, which is why you get such a significant blurring from non-direct detector cameras. Our current cameras essentially capture but it's a very shallow region. They've been thinned quite a bit, specifically to try to sort of ignore a lot of this scattering. But these hybrid pixel arrays have really, really massive pixels that actually capture the entire potential scattering of the electrons and then localize it to a specific point. So pros, incredible DQE. I have a DQE curve from at least one of these cameras on the next slide, and incredibly fast, 10 kilohertz frame rate, which is much, much faster than the ones that we're currently using. The downside is that they're huge. Each pixel for at least this dexterous, this one, dexterous Iger 1M, is 75 microns squared, compared to 5 microns for the K2 and K3 cameras that we usually use. So the K3 camera is a 4K by 5K image, so about 4,000 by 5,000 pixels, whereas this dexterous camera is only 1,000 by 500. So you get a much, much smaller viewing area, which means less data, lower throughput for data collection, which isn't great. But super interesting, because you get DQE curves that look like this, which is incredible. These are at the same scale. This is one camera at different accelerating voltages. So we now have, very interestingly, a camera that actually works better at lower accelerating voltages, which is the opposite that is true for these CMOS detectors that we're used to using. So there have been cases, again, we'll talk about it in Journal Club, where we've gotten high resolution reconstructions from these detectors at 100 keV. So super interesting cameras that hopefully we can solve some of these engineering problems and will push resolution of EM even further.
Yeah. Does that curve continue falling off as you go higher in?
This is a limit.
So if you keep taking those steps down in kilovolts, does that keep falling down in efficiency? If you go up to 150 kilovolt or 200 kilovolt or 300?
I would assume so. Based on what I know about these detectors, they actually work a little worse.
Okay. Does it crash off at any point, or is it a nice smooth fall off?
It is the use of these detectors for single particle EM, the stuff that we're interested in where these curves are really important, is something that happened in 2019. This is incredibly recent stuff. So this DQE curve was produced by the manufacturer in collaboration with Chris Russo's lab at the LMB last year. So I don't know if they actually tested them at higher resolutions, but this is fairly recent stuff. But it'll be interesting to see if they can make one that works better at higher resolution.
What are the energies that the left plot is done at?
These are all at probably 300.
Okay.
I mean, well, 416 might be lower.
Okay.
I don't know if they're all done at 300.
They may not be.
They're probably different voltages.
Can make one to 300, maybe.
It depends on the microscope that they're in, right? So this F416, we have a 120 keV with this kind of camera. We also have a 200 keV with that kind of camera. I don't imagine anybody would put one in a Prius. I don't know if they standardize this, but you can. People have looked at these similar curves at 2 and 300 keV, because you'll have a K2 and 200 keV scopes, and the DQE is definitely worse at lower accelerating voltages. That's definitely true. So that brings us to the end of at least my little talk. Some slight housekeeping notes. Not tomorrow's practical, it's Wednesday's practical.
Wednesday 3:30.
3:30 in this room. We're going to do some hands-on stuff on some of our microscopes here. Again, students taking the course for credit will present Journal Club stuff that'll start on January 22nd. So if you're taking it for credit, I'll also send this out in the email, but here are your Journal Club assignments. So if you need emails from your collaborators, let me know, or you can all try to find each other. I'll probably send out an email with everyone's email address associated with their name. So I tried to give everyone their first choice. If you signed up later, you might have gotten an assignment that wasn't quite what you wanted. Might have changed because I think we had somebody else. But everyone else, of course, is welcome and encouraged to attend. Our grad students are going to give little presentations. For grad students taking it for credit, if you can't make it to any one of the journal clubs, you have to do a little write-up on the paper or set of papers. But the first one is going to be on plunge freezing, so we're going to go back to some sample prep stuff. Then after that, it's some microscope anatomy stuff, looking at what voltages are best for biological samples. We're doing Yifan Cheng's TRIP V1 structure as sort of the beginning of the resolution revolution, and then ending the course with a somewhat controversial publication, the HIV structured field. And if we're lucky, we'll have Jay Gorman, who's one of our postdocs here, who actually is an HIV structural biologist here to answer questions, because he was working in the field when this paper was published.
He was going to conferences when they were talking about that paper.
Yeah. It's a paper, and then the other two are basically Richard Henderson and Marin Van Heel, two like founding fathers of biological TEM, saying, yeah, this paper's junk. Got a structure from images of noise. So some pitfalls in EM and challenges to doing reconstructions. So that's it.
So the class size is a lot larger than we expected. So therefore, we're trying to retool some of our practical. And so the reason why we finished up so soon would be, were there topics that we didn't cover from last week, or things that you didn't understand from going over really quickly the anatomy of the microscope and detectors? We're going to have a little bit more of that when we get you onto a microscope. They'll be breaking up to a few more stations again, but if you're on a screener with Micah, you'll be able to see how knobs change certain things. When you're more closer to your Krios with me, the main thing is in the MCCAD area, we're building Krios instruments, and I'll be able to open up doors. I'll be able to show you things like we talked about water for lenses. I can show you that water loop. So that's what I can do, but that'll be more of a show and tell on the Krios rather than have you twiddle knobs on the Krios. So moving on from there, does anyone have any particular questions or topics that they felt was just too lightly covered? And so we're giving ample time for this right now.
But for anatomy, you've got an EM engineer. So if you have burning questions that no one's been able to answer, you probably can. Yeah, anybody can.
So now in terms of, I'll step back to last week after lecture. Given now that we know a little bit more about the microscope and the samples that we want to look at, was it clear why we did the four stations as we did? So, because we didn't have much time to wrap up in the end. So in the sense that when you're, I talked to some people about support films, we had a station where we floated carbon. So I mentioned, though we demonstrated floating carbon, it's continuous carbon. You could float ordered carbon, graphene, you could float lipids, you could float anything onto your grid. So the station was the demo that, let's say you want to deposit a very thin layer in addition to your support film, how would that process go? And there are certain cases where you might have a membrane protein or you want to have an affinity grid where you concentrate certain things. So although we talked about things being electron transparent, there are certain cases where you want to actually put a film there because you want to answer certain biological questions. The reason why we showed you spotted on, that was a little bit obvious because that was in contrast to blot systems, the blot-free systems, and how that can change certain things and how you can design other experiments for that. And then moving on to here, which we will not get into too much, but we didn't really talk about vacuum systems that heavily at all. And there are several types of pumps. And so the reason why we skipped that is that during the demo, I can tell you and assure you what the various pumps are, from pre-vacuum pump to oil diffusion pumps to turbos to IGPs, and give you a better sense of the vacuum ranges, because there are things that Grant talked about, differential apertures, in the sense that we can have several orders of magnitude change of vacuum in our EM, and that doesn't impinge on our imaging, and it's actually on purpose because we want to have higher vacuum for our electron source, and for our projection chamber where we have a camera, we don't need as high vacuum. So I'm starting to talk, but I want to stop from lecturing because I want to see where everyone is, because now that we have such a large class, some people are intermediate advanced, or some people are more intermediate beginner, and some people are beginner. So we want to differentiate the class such that we touch upon all the subjects in enough depth that you start going beyond what we can look at it.
Grant Jensen lectures are just that clear. How many people watch Grant Jensen at 1x?
Okay.
2x? 3x? Okay. So I think Grant knows, but we typically watch at least 1.5 to 2 times when we're playing on YouTube.
It gets really weird if you then go back to watching it. 1x. It feels like slow motion.
And then when you talk to Grant in person, it's like, oh, wow, that is actually really tough. And that's fine. That's really clear. It's great for teaching.
Yeah.
But when you look at the material 3 times, 5 times, probably a dozen times for us, we're like, okay, let's go.
Yeah, so is 300 kilovolt optimal voltage for single watt AVL, or if not, there are some other voltage you could have?
It is potentially not optimal. That is actually, this journal club right here on February 5th suggests that 300 kilo electron volt is actually not the best for the vast majority of single particle samples. That we should be using something more in the range of 100 kilo electron volts.
But if you buy a Titan Krios, that's designed to be at 300 kV. And
don't just like turn it down to 100.
And you buy a camera that's designed to be at like 400 kV, and you put it on a 300 kV instrument, then you want to be as high as possible.
So 300 kV is optimal right now because our best microscopes are designed to work at that voltage. But again, it goes back to this trade-off between specimen damage and sample penetration. You need to be able to actually move through your whole sample without electrons hitting atoms and losing energy, which just contributes to noise. We'll talk more about this. It's a ratio of elastic scattering versus inelastic scattering, which Grant Jensen will talk about when you watch that video series on image formation. So if we can design a really, really good microscope with a really, really good camera that works really well at 100 keV, it might actually be better. Now, whether or not that actually means you'll get to higher resolution with your particular protein sample mostly is dependent upon your particular biochemistry. That could push the resolution of apoferritin, something that we can routinely get to low 2 angstroms, sometimes below 2 angstroms. But if you've got a complex that's falling apart or something that's really flexible, a better quote unquote voltage in your microscope probably isn't going to change it all much.
There's a few considerations with the theoretically what's the best voltage, also cost-wise, right?
It's another one of the benefits. Yeah.
There's certain things that if you could have cheaper components, then you could have and you could have economy of scale, and that would be more useful. So in truth, a 100 keV microscope is a lot cheaper to maintain than a 300. And a megavolt is extremely hard to maintain because you need 2 floors. Literally, you go up stairs to put your sample in, and you go back downstairs to run it.
Can I put a picture?
Do you have a picture? You can look that up. So yeah. there's one in Japan, and there's another one in Albany. I don't know which one you can find. So therefore, 100 keV was sort of that nice. You could have 100 keV FEG with the right optics, and with the detector you just saw, that should be very economical, and you would be able to do quite a bit with that.
That's a good question.
Yes. Please do.
With the coding that we were talking about last time, I was wondering if there's ever an issue with clipping, or like when you screw the grid in for screening or looking at, like, is there ever an issue with like the layer that's on top? Like if you, I imagined like if you kind of do that ring on the outside or clip it, like could it somehow like break the layer on top or?
Oh yeah, same thing mechanical could, it's just practice and being very careful.
I've had that happen a lot actually. Not a lot, but every once in a while.
You can get crinkly.
I use gold grids most of the time, or most of the things that I use.
Is that gold coating on top of carbon grids?
Gold coating on top of gold grid bars.
Okay.
So you can get gold grid bars with carbon on top of them that are much cheaper and they come in way faster. If you try to buy gold on gold, they're usually back ordered months and they're super expensive. But because we have this gold evaporator, I can just buy the carbon coated gold grids. You know, evaporate some gold on top of them and then remove the carbon, and then I'll have my own sort of homemade gold grids.
Okay.
But there have been times when I have clipped them to go into a Krios, or I've just loaded them into one of our side entry holders. And that mechanical stress of like securing it either into an auto grid or into the holder itself has actually dislodged the gold support film, and then the grid's lost.
EM grids poorly are a circular form factor. There are other materials that are not poorly EM, but are EM compatible that are hexagonal or square. Some of the silicon wafer technology, it's better for squares. And you could retrofit a holder to get it in for an EM holder. There are other transfer tips. So in addition, a grid, depending on the manufacturer of microscope, there are different form factors that you would need to do to accommodate that grid. So normal side entry holder systems, you can just put the circular grid right in, and by tension, it clamps down. On the more advanced systems, whether it's, let's say, the Krios auto grid, where you have sort of a C-clip and a washer, the JOL system has a cartridge system where you do a turn. Even the side entry holder, let's say the Catan ELSA or some of the Fission systems, it's sort of a washer and a ring that you screw in. So anytime you have to do a screwing motion, a turning motion, you could literally just break and crumple your grid by over tightening. The grids overall are only a few microns thick, they're extremely fragile, but that form factor, you have to be very careful. So that's why these cartridge systems or these auto grid systems came about, because that adds stiffness, and then you can pick up the grid without mashing it, as long as you can get in there in the first place. I still have not heard the real reason why grids are round. I think it's a convenient form factor that if you're doing tomography, because if you're doing a 0 and a 90, you can turn your grid, and you can always do a tilt series. Mm-hmm. So if it was a odd form factor, let's say with straight edges, and you turned it, then you might have an incompatible form factor if your sample is not on there in a uniform direction. There you go.
There you go.
A couple story microscope.
Mega electron wolf microscope. Crazy.
I don't know if they use imaging plates or film, but that is commonly used as a detector.
We didn't talk about film, but people used to use film back
you
in the dark.
You are
ages.
Sitting where there used to be a cold, what do you call it, a dark room. It was converted into a conference room. So we used to have a cold room and a dark room, no longer, because everything is now digitized. Some people still love film quite a bit because storage. Some from these direct detectors, you can get terabytes and terabytes of data. If you have a film negative, yes, it takes up space, but if you properly develop it, it lasts for decades and decades and decades. Your hard drive will not last for decades and decades and decades.
Yeah.
What's the purpose of these mega electron volt ones? Like, are there really that many samples where you can only put it in that to get a decent resolution?
No idea. I have no idea what they're used for.
Just really, really thick samples. It's very... It was at a time when they were really going up and up and up in KV. They're expensive. Not too many of them are heavily used because for biological space, we don't have as many applications. I forgot the one in Albany, how old it is, but I heard it takes a half a day to align it. So whereas you can align a Krios, where we can say I feel comfortable enough to use it in an hour, if you did that, you probably need all day on that microscope to feel that hour's worth of Krios alignment, feel how stable and comfortable you are before proceeding to your experiment.
Stuff that's really thick in probably material science.
Material science would be a very good candidate.
So again, the faster that electron moves, the less likely it is to interact inelastically with something in your sample, right? It's got a larger scattering cross-section, but nothing biological.
I'm just curious, how big do you think the EM field is? Are we in hundreds, thousands?
Like number of labs?
Millions? No, just number of researchers.
Number of researchers.
And then of that, how big do you think the cryo-EM field is? So we probably are at, I don't know, if you can combine industry, I mean, we could be easily in the millions of people that use EM across EM.
In the
but
world? Or
in the world, yes. I mean, between material science, semiconductor industry, and us. But how many of those people are doing Crow EM? And that will give you a better idea of how nascent this field is and how far we've come along. The main buyer of EMs up until, I don't know, a year or so ago was material science.
So manufacturers cater microscopes towards that.
Yeah. And in a couple of years, material science will probably come back up again. They're the main buyer of electron microscopes. So for every Krios you would sell, you would probably get a material science version of that. You might get several more sold.
And it's as high as it's ever been for cryo-EM.
Yes.
The field is at its peak right now.
Yes, correct.
5 years ago, cryo-EM was an even tinier little itty-bitty sliver of electron microscopy. A sliver of structural biology that most people didn't care about.
So the main purpose of that would give you a better idea how the tool was developed and for what field it had the greatest development in, and that's in the material science side. It just so happens that using maybe only 10% of the features, we can do a lot in the volatile side. We don't use stem mode. We don't use diffraction mode that much. There's a lot of modes on an EM that we don't really make use of for what people think of cryo-EM, which is single particle cryo-EM. And that's even a large segment, but it's even a segment of a segment. It's just interesting to see. Because the same thing of a cyclotron, if you think like, okay, how many people use it for X-ray crystallography? Well, now, yes, that's all it's used for. But if you go back a few decades, there's still other uses for cyclotron, but it's heavily swayed one way versus the other.
Yeah.
About the detectors, like I may have zoned out in the video when he was explaining it, but I have a hard time visualizing like how the detector is knowing like which hole you're at, or is it just like all there, and so then therefore seeing it, like how the camera, like I have just a hard time visualizing how is it seeing.
We do multi-scale imaging for biological fields. We tend to practice low dose methods, and we take a map of the area, then we go in, and then is your question, so from a hole in the grid, how does that actually get imaged by the detector?
Yeah, like when we're looking at one micrograph that we would maybe use in a collection,
right,
to see the particles, like how is the detector from that, like seems like it would cover the whole thing, so how is it getting that small amount?
Magnification,
okay.
And we are probably not targeting as accurately as we think we're targeting, but we have a lot of give. So multi-scale imaging is in the sense that by practicing low dose, we don't burn our sample, but we take intermediate magnifications, as Mike was saying. Our lens system is not perfect, and so let's say you go from one mag to another mag, and it's not calibrated, you're not actually in the same place, and you really even know where you are. So during the alignment process, because Mike is really good at this because he's always a perfectly aligned microscope.
Sure.
So you can tell from the highest mag, that atom, all the way up to the lowest mag, if you pinpoint something, it'll just translate all the way through. So that's how accurate, but that's an alignment that you would have to do.
But the magnified image covers the entire detector, right? You get the sort of...
Right.
Okay.
So we're
illuminated
there.
The camera then?
Yeah,
yes.
We use the two
okay.
terms interchangeably.
Okay.
The detector is just a camera.
Okay.
We usually actually have multiple cameras or multiple different types of detectors on our microscopes. The Krioses have three
cameras?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sometimes
and
four?
Sometimes four. At different points, we have. So on the older microscopes, as I said, we can't see electrons. So one way we can do that is, you hit a phosphor screen that kicks out photons, then you can see indirectly electrons. So we have what's called a flue cam to look at that. We have
this is for like usually well not necessarily low mag, but
right.
You can also look at it in high mag. but we use this a lot for, you'll see this on Wednesday, we'll look at the sort of phosphor screen. So each detector has its own sort of role in, usually only have one that collects high resolution information. Some of them are used for gathering images at different magnifications for certain reasons, and others are used for calibration or alignment of the microscope because it's just easier or faster to use that camera. Usually the really high resolution ones can be kind of slow, relatively speaking. Right? You take a picture, you wait for it to show up on a screen, and then you do something, and then take another one, as opposed to that phosphor screen, which is live. Right? It's almost like constantly streaming this information, so you can make changes to things and see.
I don't think you even went over frame rate. So yeah, we have that camera, we have a CMOS camera, and then we have a CMOS camera that's a direct detector. That takes movies.
Used for all sorts of different things.
Those are the minimum three. The minimum we might have two on some microscopes.
Yeah, at least two.
But as Mike was saying, the information is different. So the direct detectors, the frame rate for our movies can be anywhere from tens of milliseconds to seconds. CCDs, 10 and CMOS cameras that are not direct detectors, or if you use a direct detector in an integrated mode, just using as a normal camera, you're typically in like half second to seconds regime for the frame itself, and you're only taking one frame in that sense. And the fluid cam or any of the live view, it's just real time, so it's almost like a video camera in the sense that it's just literally streaming live.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, it really depends on what you're trying to do. You can use a direct detector as an integrated camera, meaning not collecting movies. The movie length typically would be related to your dose. So some people take doses anywhere from the order of 10 electrons per angstrom squared to 200 electrons per angstrom squared. And that really dictates the size of that movie or the size of that image. Because any more, you just damage your sample and you won't see anything. For a direct detector, that can end up being terabytes of information per day. For a CCD, that can be low gigabytes. And so that's the difference of just taking an image or an image that we actually refer to as a movie.
Mm-hmm.
That's several orders of magnitude. To give you context, if from 2015 until today, we collected and saved every single image we took and we did not compress, we would need on the order of 15 petabytes of storage. I don't know if you're thinking in petabytes, but there's megabytes, gigabytes, terabytes, petabytes.
Okay.
That's good and bad, but that's what you have to think of. And not every image we take is a direct detector. But that is just direct detector use. If you just added the CCD images, that's easy. That's only a few terabytes.
Yeah.
Sometimes during post-processing, you're correcting for anisotropic magnification.
Yeah.
Where is that anisotropy coming from?
There are many different places, but you hope it's from your projection system.
Is that related to lenses on the microscope? Or
yes.
Yeah. So these are imperfections in that lens system that we correct for it as much as we can, but the system is never going to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
So, or actually, I've gone over mechanical ways that the microscope, built inside of the microscope, we try to correct for astigmatism, anisotropic magnification. There are lots of other things that we try to correct for when we align the microscope.
So do you basically expect magnification to change during the collection?
No. You assume that it's essentially the same.
Yeah, I'm asking basing that on like lens hysteresis, for example.
Mag anisotropy specifically? Is that your question? Magnification anisotropy?
Mm-hmm.
The specific term would be you have a square pixel coming in, but then you have a rectangle coming out. And that's not due to stigmation. So and that could be different depending on your magnification, because the lenses are not perfect. And so that's literally what's happening. You think it's really point spread, where you think you have a point, but instead of a circle, you have an oval. And that is something that is inherent to the lens. If you have a glass lens, they're really good at manufacturing that out, and you have very little stigmation. You have very little of that anisotropy, as it were. But that is apparent even if you correct for that. So one way of detecting that would be you would take an image, and you would take a diffraction image of that. So then it wouldn't be stigmation based, because if you take a diffraction image, that would be. So that's inherent to that lens itself. On top of that, you have, you know, objective condenser and gun stigmators if you could do that. But that won't necessarily correct all of it. And so the magnification anisotropy test that we typically do would be, you would use a crystal, you would take the diffraction pattern of that, and you would look how circular it is. Ideally, it should be perfect, but if it's not, then you would say that's coming from the lens. For most of what we do, our rule of thumb is that we want that to be less than 1%. When you get on to the order of 2%, that's quite dangerous, because imagine your pixel is 2% off in a direction, and you have an alpha helix that's really long, and you're going through. You can miss a turn or so. And so that's why people want to correct for that. And you may or may not have a resolution jump, but the map quality would be a lot better and be more reflective of reality. Because what you don't want is physics to be broken. You need bonds to be a certain length. And so that's beyond a calibration where, like, oh, I just have the wrong pixel size, I can just scale your map. No, but still, there's something wrong about that map. And that could be due to magnification anisotropy. That's something that you may want to worry about if you, let's say, merge data between microscopes. You can merge data between different KVs, different microscopes, and different detectors. However, you have to account for all the aberrations from the microscope. So it's easiest to merge data from the same microscope, because you're merging a data set with the same aberrations as the next data set. But if you're merging between microscopes, you try your best to take into account for those aberrations, correct for that, and then you will have a better time merging data. But software-wise, you can have great effect. There's a microscope I know, Titan Krios, that has over 2% magnetoscopy, and that will impact resolution as well. And you can get severe artifacts if you don't correct for that. But that's magnification anisotropy, that term specific.
Yeah, so at 300 kV, the speed of electron is 70% of light.
76.
76, so for this 1 MB, like, what is the speed of electron?
That's a good question.
So
at this speed, normally fairly easy to convert from this voltage system, given that we know the mass of an electron, right? We can get the velocity pretty easy. But at this speed, it gets relativistic. So I think you just use the mass and the velocity, or the mass and the voltage. At 300 keV, you're like 106% the speed of light. Clearly, that's not how it works, but there is a calculator, because I did it manually once, but it's not super straightforward. So there is a.
Can I do that? Maybe it's also worth mentioning if an electron, sometimes they get scattered in the material, and they go fast, and they go almost like mentioned, like 3/4 of the speed of light. But they lose energy if they get scattered.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a company, Gatan, and they make a filter that takes benefit of it. So what it does is the beam comes down and then goes around the corner. And you get like the same effect as what you see with a rainbow, that you pull apart the faster and the slower electrons. So the faster electrons will be laterally split on a different position than the slower ones. And then if you make a little slit, you actually see exactly the electrons you want to see that had the right interaction. So you get a very good contrast. And because they have different speeds, some make it around the corner, some don't make it at all. So you can really select the image you want to see.
And these energy filters, I think there's a Grant Jensen video on energy filters, right?
It should be in part one.
So you should have watched it before this, which is why I didn't talk about it. But we will also talk about those elastic versus inelastic electrons next week when we go over image formation and Fourier transform. But to answer your question, at a mega electron volt, right? 1,000 kilo electron volts, 94% the speed of light. So
imagine you're going through that in air, that's how you burn out quite a bit.
Yeah.
All that energy has to be deposited somewhere. So now just thinking about it.
Newtonian, it's 108%. But
oh my goodness. How many electrons do you think are in a column at any given period of time?
That's a good question. If you could like freeze the electrons.
If you just stop time, how many electrons do you think might be in a column? That's the right order.
What?
One. Basically have an electron move through the column, experience the sample, contribute some information to the image, and then like a long pause, relatively speaking, and then another electron comes back. That's how quickly they move. I mean, you think the column itself is a couple of feet, right? Even at a creos, which are huge, and it's traveling at nearly the speed of light, so from emerging from the electron gun to reaching the detector is nearly instantaneous.
Why is it called a beam?
We use a lot of optics terms.
Yeah.
It's a microscope, it's an optic.
We even just refer to it as optics. Like, I've said, I think, several times during my talk, like, oh, this microscope has better optics, even though we're not dealing with light. So we call it a beam because it's a microscope. And
okay. The energy going down.
Yeah.
I have a question. Is it common to have a lot of microscopes go down or crash? Or Columbia has a bunch of issue with like a bunch of new microscopes failing us, and I don't know how common that is. Or
yeah, a lot of these technology, they're on the hairy edge of what's possible. It's especially if you've a brand new the FK3s at Columbia. Yeah, then so production is really they do their best to test everything, and once it's in the factory, it's approved, everything works. But imagine sometimes you have to ship it on the other side of the world and realign it, assemble it, and then the local engineer has to test it. So there's still a lot of steps that can go wrong. And so it could be anything from material quality to little hair. Could do. Often when we install a camera, we take a little optical microscope to inspect the CCD and see if there's any hairs or debris. Because if there's any hair, you cannot use the camera. It's like you might still get some particles that you can use for your reconstruction, but once you hit the hair with a beam, it's going to evaporate. You don't know where it ends. And then there's contaminations that can go on your camera. So there's a lot of stuff that have to be right to make it work. And I don't know what the technical term is, meantime between failure, but typically if you have a very state-of-the-art instrument, in the beginning you have a lot of infant problems, then everybody learns how to do it optimally, and then you have like a steady state. And then we have a Tecna here on site that's already, I think, 15 years old or so. So it was already installed before I even joined FEI. And that has now like wear on parts, like O-rings that start leaking, braids that start snapping. And that's typically what you see end of life. And then the MTBF goes up again. And then it's more an economical decision to say, hey, we get rid of this microscope, we need a new one because it gets too difficult to maintain it anymore. But typically, Columbia has state-of-the-art equipment. It will take about a year to stabilize.
A lot of it, at least for the Emmett Zuckerman Institute, and a lot of the issues with our microscope there, camera related. The K3s are new.
You have fields, too.
Yeah. Well, it's actually pretty stable.
Okay.
It's, according to Thermo, one of the better microscopes that they've seen.
You have active and passive cancellation.
So we have, it's one of the potential sources of stigmation or differences in these lenses, or really anything in the microscope, is electromagnetic radiation from the room or the area surrounding your microscope. So we don't normally worry about it so much for our low-end screening microscopes, though they are shielded somewhat. But things like a Krios, there are extensive room renovations that go into canceling out all of the electromagnetic radiation. Zuckerman's is pretty good, even though it's right next to the one train, which I think would just like vibrate the entire building all the time. But a lot of that's, yeah, a lot of our issues at least have been camera based. And part of it is because you have one company making the camera and then a different company making the microscope. The company making the microscope tried to buy the company that makes the cameras. European antitrust laws said no. So, still made by two different companies. But it should hopefully get worked out soon-ish.
Yeah.
Be nice.
What do you think an acceptable uptime would be for a microscope? You shouldn't ask me because I'm on a different perspective, but as a user, what would you expect?
What was the question?
As a user, what did you expect the uptime for a microscope to be?
Uptime in like time for
so, so let's
it?
Say yes, like out
yeah.
of the year, would you think you can use it half the time, 3/4 of the time, 90% of the time? Or does that mean like I
don't
hear
think
that
it should ever go down.
So it doesn't matter if it's down weekends, during the weekday show it be up. Or just
yeah.
like that it should always be up. That's a very hard thing because it's actually a tool and it's very to get that. I made an analogy a few days back to cars where you could have like a nice Civic, you can get a Ferrari, and you can get a Formula One car. So a Krios is somewhere between like a Ferrari and a Formula One car, where we don't rebuild it after each experiment, but it's that high tech and it needs that amount of commensurate maintenance. So imagine you don't, let's say you have a Formula One car, you do zero maintenance, you have zero pit crew. That's not even going to last a couple laps. It's going to just die. So that's what happens when you have really high end equipment. You need that amount of effort to maintain it.
But our goal, at least here, is to make sure that they are collecting constantly. And this is true for Columbia. There's a lot of discussion, I'll say, back and forth about who's going to start when,
mm-hmm.
who's got enough samples to collect for a certain amount of time, because these are huge investments. So ideally, they would be up and collecting high-resolution data constantly, unless it's down for like regular preventative maintenance, like
right.
cryocycling, right, warming it up, or annealing the detector, which just means warming up the detector and then cooling it back down. Should be all the time. Well, it's 5 o'clock. If y'all want to leave, you are now more than welcome. You could have left. Now you're allowed to.
See you Wednesday, 3:30.
Everybody fill out the sign-in sheet.
If you, cool. Especially if you don't get an email from Micah, do add your email.
Today,
I put you on the first one. January 22nd. It's a plunge freezing.
Oh, so I'm gonna go staying in or
the? Yeah, I'm gonna stay on the west side. The one.
Yeah. So the.
No, probably you have to go
there's
back
three.
To like speak
again. Somebody
yeah,
else registered.
Okay.
Anyway.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
After I had changed.